Well, greetings, everybody, and welcome again to Shepherd's Voice Magazine. We're sure happy you could be here with us, and hopefully you enjoy today's message and find it useful to you. Folks, the life of a believer from the Old Testament times up until the present time that we live in now is much about waiting. Waiting on the Lord is a commonly noted thread in most of Scripture, and we've heard a lot about it over the years. But there may be a misconception out there, however, that those who wait on the Lord don't actually have much to do with the outcome of the Lord's plans, or in particular, His timing. You see, waiting can sound like a kind of a stagnant thing, and it's typically associated with an unproductive period or use of time. But waiting in the Christian sense shouldn't be considered as a passive or an idle thing. And that's kind of where we're going to go today. It's not about killing time, it's not about passing time, or just putting in time for that matter. You see, waiting on the Lord, which in no small way applies to each and every one of us, is full of end time significance. And hopefully, as we'll see today, and as the scripture will imply as we read on, it has an impact on the Lord's timetable. And hopefully we'll come away from today noting that waiting on the Lord is actually something that's full of anticipation. It's purposeful, and it's full of purposeful activity and excitement, actually. And it happens to be connected directly with the future. And since no calling is higher than the one that we've received from Jesus Christ, well, we ought to consider the present possibilities that we have to know we are being productive. And this has something to do with biblical direction. Because, you see, without direction, you know, we can't be active in our waiting. And that's kind of what we're going to be really driving at today, is the fact that this waiting on the day of the Lord isn't just sitting there like a bump, well, just sitting here waiting for Jesus to come back. And it's not how we need to consider this. This is actually something that, as we'll see, will stir us up, okay? And that's what today is all about. So as we said, to be active in our waiting, we need direction. Because without it, it turns into a passive thing. Okay, and that can lead to boredom. And boredom inevitably leads to disinterest. And especially, and I hope you're picking up what I'm laying down here, it'll lead to disinterest in the things that are important. And we have to be fairly considerate of what those things actually are. You see, historically, the direction given for readiness, okay, contained an inordinate amount of emphasis on the imminent return of Jesus Christ. And not that that's not important, because it is. It is absolutely important. However, when we get our learning and our understanding all out of whack, and we focus all our energy and our attention in only one direction, it can lead us down a pretty dangerous path, because, as we'll see, you know, we don't want to be stagnant. We don't want to be led into a place of boredom or disinterest. So what happened there was when we got our focus all out of whack there, and was that it resulted in chronic speculation. And people focusing in an unhealthy way on world events. And this is, I say historic, because it's kind of how things went throughout the lineage of the Sabbath keeping church as we might know it. You know, I come from a time in growing up in the worldwide Church of God. I often joke, I come from a time when Garner Ted, Gerald Fleury, Meredith, all of them were all in the same group. If you can imagine any grouping of those folks, you know, even being able to sit in the same room together. They were all together at the same time, and this was definitely the emphasis that was placed on our faith and belief system in general, was this inordinate amount of focus on the return of Christ. And it did lead to an unhealthy amount of speculating on dates and times, and everybody wondered when Jesus Christ was going to come back and trying to put a time on it. And I remember calendars and graphs and you name it. Okay? That's passive waiting, folks. That's what we're going to find out today. That's passive waiting. And watching was a key word that was used. We have to watch. And that particular focus was derived from a misrepresentation of what we can read in Matthew 24 and 42. Verse 42, where we read, "Therefore be alert, since you don't know what day your Lord is coming." Be alert, or watch therefore. And we've done messages here on SVM about that in the past. But it was suggesting that Christ commanded that we should be watching the world events so that believers would be prepared. And I think we fleshed out in numerous messages here how that's a mug's game, folks. It's not where our focus needs to be. It's not our job. You see, because waiting can use up our time, and those who don't properly wait, as the scriptures would instruct and as we can read, well, we'll lose the battle on time. We'll simply lose the battle on time. And what we're going to discuss today is the scriptural understanding of waiting on the Lord that produces some results, and results that are sustainable. And as we said, this is to stir you up. Waiting, it might imply, as we said, some sort of passivity or some sort of stagnation. But it's not. It's there to stir you up. This waiting is about stirring you up, and the Apostle Peter seemed to recognize the tendency of a believer to settle into a lower state of energy that isn't conducive to progress and moving ahead. And of course, we're talking about progress and moving ahead in our understanding. In his second epistle, he twice states that he wishes to stir you up. And this is what this message is even entitled today, Stir You Up. And in doing so, Peter shows us how to wait on the Lord that's in a manner that is sustainable. The second reference to stirring up his readers relates to the future. And we said that this the future relates to us, okay? So let's see how this relates to the future. Turn, if you want, to 2 Peter chapter 3. We're going to begin in verse 1 and go on to verse 4. Beloved, I now write to you the second epistle, in both of which I stir up your pure minds by the way of reminder, that you may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets, and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior. And I think we've noted here before, he says apostles, there was more than one, of the Lord and Savior. Knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last days, walking according to their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. And what is strongly implied here is that these scoffers are actually believers. They're actually believers, or folks that were on the way to becoming believers. They were believers in they were being grown into believers. And Peter gives us the direction that we need so that perhaps we might be less likely to stumble and head down a path of unconversion. And it's sobering if we might consider that, you know, we can be in a place of both, of either being converted or on the way to being unconverted. And that is sobering. But you see, what the scoffer doesn't understand is how their view of time isn't the same as God's view of time. And that's something else that we've drilled down on here before. You see, we all have a narrow little sliver in our existence. And our view of time is actually quite limited. And the mistake occurring there is that we tend to extrapolate on time as we know it now, in the now, and all the way into the past. And we also do it all the way into the future, and our consciousness of history is so extremely limited, brethren. And we have to be aware that scoffers will tend to argue from this limited standpoint of time. And Peter recognized the need to deal with time in this particular framework. The matter of time, which is God's view versus man's view, as we noted just a second ago. And then he dealt with the value of the physical. So again, let's stay in 2 Peter. Go to verse 10 of chapter 3. We're already there in chapter 3. Verse 10, "But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with a fervent heat, and both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up." All right. So what we can take from that is that the value of the physical isn't actually worth very much. It's going to be burnt up. It's going to be gone. And 1 Peter 1 and verse 24 says that all flesh is grass. So we need to keep that in mind. The physical is not worth very much. So in there we see kind of the value that God puts on the physical, which isn't a very high one. And so in this, hopefully we can see the contrast in the Lord's view on what is actually of value, and also man's view of time versus his view of time. Okay, so what follows then, after Peter zeroed in on the Lord's view of time and what the value the Lord puts on physical things, then is Peter's encouragement regarding what connects us with the day of the Lord from the point we are at now, from where we are now. So that brings us around to, how do we wait? How do we wait? 2 Peter 3 again. Let's continue in 2 Peter 3. Let's drop down to verse 11. We'll read through to verse 13. It says, "Therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness?" Holy conduct and godliness. "Looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be dissolved, being on fire, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells." We like to kind of acknowledge the Greek when we read these scriptures and when we present these messages. In the original Greek, the words translated here, holiness and godliness, that I noted there as we were reading this, they're both plural. They're both plural. And it needs to be emphasized that these are not static states of being, but rather very, very active and productive. And it means that they are about varied activity, and they attract attention, and they will indeed produce results. And I want us to also note that the words "looking for" and "hastening," these aren't passive turns of phrase either. These are things that require our attention. Jude wrote in Jude 21 about looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. Friends, this is similar to us asking, who can I forgive and how can I expand my capacity to forgive? Which is a huge component of what we're doing in this waiting on the day of the Lord. You see, looking for the Lord in the gospel sense is an advancing sense of self in the light of the Lord's character. In light of the Lord's character, which is holiness and godliness. Holiness, you know, to be set apart. And that's expressed a number of ways by Peter. And we'll look at just a couple of those here right now, because it means to be getting about our own sanctification. And that's found in 1 Peter 1, 14-19. It says, as obedient children, do not be conformed to the desires of your former ignorance. But as the one who called you is holy, you are to be holy in all your conduct. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. And if you appeal to the Father who judges impartially according to each one's work, you are to conduct yourselves in reverence during your time living as strangers. In verse 18, for you know that you were redeemed from your empty way of life inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of an unblemished and spotless lamb. That's getting about our own sanctification. And it's about realizing your expression of love for the brethren. You can read about that in 1 Peter 1:22. I won't turn there. And it's about behaving lawfully under man's jurisdiction. And we can read that in 1 Peter 2, in verse 13 and 14. You can turn there if you like. It says, submit to every human authority because of the Lord, whether to the emperor as the supreme authority or to the governors as those sent out by him to punish those who do what is evil and to praise those who do what is good. So we're supposed to definitely fall in line with good governance and be law-abiding. But here's where the rubber really meets the road, folks, because it means also that we have to be willing to embrace suffering. And this is something that we've definitely spoken tons about here. 1 Peter 4, 1-6 says, therefore, since Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same understanding, because the one who suffers in the flesh is finished with sin. And I'll let you carry on reading through to verse 6. But I hope you can understand the significance of what we're digging into here. You see, godliness is imparted to us as we nurture the work of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit working in us. And Peter does mention godliness in association with power in verse 3 of 2 Peter 1. And we have to understand that the Holy Spirit is power. And what's striking in this scripture is that it suggests that our holiness and godliness hastens the day. And I want us to kind of have a look at that for a moment here, because it's very curious that Peter might suggest that we may be, or that we might have even the capacity to be involved in speeding up the coming of the Lord. And he's not just repeating himself there. It's not just another way of saying looking for here. And it may not seem possible, but I do want us to consider the following. The believer is part of advancing the kingdom of God. And the work that his servants are involved in is in cooperation with the work that the Father and the Son have actively engaged in. And you can read all about that in John 5:17. But the upshot here is that the ministry of man cooperates with God's program so that promised events are going to take place. And hopefully we can put looking for and hastening in terms of the day of the Lord together and understand how our present activity sustains our hold on the future. It sustains our very hold on the future. And it is far superior than the strategies offered up to watch world events and get all bent out of shape in our speculating and calendar deriving and all of this. And we don't want to be caught up in this whole assigning events as signs of the times. Okay? It's backward spiritual thinking. And those who are looking for and hastening the day of the Lord look at their own conduct and are looking at their own transformation, brethren, for assurance in their connection to the future. And that's because the day of the Lord is more than just an event in time. It is salvation. So are we cooperating with God's program? Because to do so takes diligence. It takes diligence. 2 Peter 1, verse 5 through to verse 7 says, "But also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love." And dropping down to verse 10 says, "Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure, for if you do these things, you will never stumble." Notice how we said Peter had some insight on giving us things that'll keep us from stumbling? There it is. You see, the suggestion is that diligent effort takes time and energy to grow the fruits of righteousness. And unfortunately, some have instead turned their time and their attention and their energies to becoming auditors of the program. And they're focused on the correcting efforts of some on the smallest of things, down to the minutiae of faith, analyzing the politics of the church at large and other, dare I say, fruitless acts. Okay? And we all need to take stock of our own activities and our own motivations in light of what we're reading here from Peter. This is because long-suffering is opportunity. And we need to consider that the long-suffering of our Lord, and that this too is salvation. Okay? We can read that in 2 Peter 3 and verse 15. And it's there where it's as though Peter returns to the aspect of time. But really, what does it mean other than long-suffering is opportunity? This is all about opportunity. You see, if we're impatient with the long-suffering of the Lord, wishing, say, time was shorter, or constantly looking for signs, then we're not with his program of active waiting. But selfishly and usually dramatically approaching the faith. And this is the slippery slope that we need to avoid. You see, in light of this, we need to understand that God's will is also creative. You see, he does make adjustments where he sees fit, and he steps in where and when he decides to. See, where there's lethargy or perhaps bad chemistry, God may make changes. And those changes may not be comfortable. They likely won't be. and oftentimes they're resented. But if we are obedient servants of God, then we're going to recognize his activity and we'll adjust to him rather than trying to make him constantly adjust the situation to suit us. You see, active minds in the truth don't get bored and they're not persuaded to doubt. So we got to ask ourselves, who's going to be ready? Jesus tells us plainly that those who will be ready and found faithful at his coming, well, he's going to find them so doing. And that's over in Matthew 24 and verse 46. So what does doing mean? Well, it means actively waiting, as we've discussed today. Second Peter 3, verse 14 says, therefore, beloved, looking forward to these things, be diligent to be found by him in peace, without spot and blameless. And here again is that proper direction in which we need to be motivated. See, endless analysis of events and prophetic speculations, or things like claiming that you have to be with one particular group or another to be acceptable, you know, you got to be with the right group. Well, these and the other types of misdirection don't stand up to Scripture. They don't pass the smell test, as it were. So let's conclude with some words from the Apostle John. I'll get you to turn with me over to 1 John 4. Let's look at verse 17. It says, Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Because as he is, so are we in this world. See, love casts out fear. And he who loves has no fear in judgment. See, these words of John can be understood by asking the simple question that John answers. How does love judge love? God is love, and he perfectly accepts those who are like him. So in light of that, there is no need to be concerned with judgment. So, brethren, if you're struggling to find certainty in your faith, or navigating through all of the claims and agendas that folks will land on you, and their institutional ideas of what church doctrine is or looks like, or what you ought to believe, then turn to the Lord, who is the author and the finisher of your faith. And he's going to show you the freedom that he has for you to embrace. And you can and will be free of fear. And more so, you'll be free to serve. And that there, brethren, is our opportunity to actively wait. So here we are. I'm out of pages. Therefore, I'm out of time. As usual, I'll hold up the book here that Jim wrote, From Babylon to America, Exposing Anglo-Israelism and Nationalism in the Churches of God. I encourage you to go on the interwebs, lulu.com, Amazon, so forth, anywhere where you buy fine quality reading products. You can get it. It's reasonably inexpensive, about $20 by the time it's shipped to you. I think that's in U.S. funds. Buy one for yourself, buy one for a friend. Folks, if you're so inclined and you can see the little thumbs up down there, give us the thumbs up. Hit the bell icon. Hopefully you can get the notifications for when these messages go out.
I want to wish each and every one of you a happy Sabbath. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you again next time on Shepherd's Voice Magazine.